You know, India, Aboriginal tribes all over the world, for so many ways, so many forms and fashion, have something called a death dance that they have. Right, they see somebody is at the edge of death, and they dance and they make, you know, hopefully to run the bad spirits away. That's what it looks like with the Republicans right now over Obamacare. It is just the scene that's playing out is bizarre, isn't it? I don't know how else to describe it.
You know, it is bizarre, Pat. This is, we are witnessing, there's no other way to describe this other than this carnival freak show pitch of failure for Obamacare, despite the facts and the information in regards to Obamacare, and in the backdrop, a society of people who are so economically in need of an economy-stabilizing mechanism by which they can access health care.
And they apparently want it. But nevertheless, India, what we're seeing is television ads. We're seeing media events. Paul Waldman did a great story where he follows all that. He talks about the PR stunts. He talks about something that looks like an electoral campaign, where you have the message being that, gee whiz, this is bad, this is the end of mankind as we know it. And the truth is, it's simply a matter of people that are going to get health insurance at good prices, and Republicans think that's bad for them. It's not certain to me how they could possibly say that's bad for them. Now, certainly it's bad from a standpoint of the people who give them money. Those are the people who want the Obamacare thing to fail, but I mean, to try to rationally argue that this is bad for the public is just beyond beyond belief. But they have the machine out doing that, don't they?
Yes, they do, and it is literally head scratching to watch this, because the reality is so the antithesis of their pitch. We have masses of Americans who are in need of economic stabilization. We know that healthcare costs are a huge percentage of the average family's income. We know that incomes are stretched to the bone in many cases, unfortunately.
Yeah, and it's headed towards 40% of the household income if we stayed on the track that we are. And of course, some people even project it's higher than that without some movement. But, you know, what I find interesting, India, is you have lawmakers, and I think, it was Waldman that talked about this in his article that he wrote on what's happening with the healthcare fight. You actually have Republican congressmen who are doing things like telling their staffers that when one of the constituents calls in, says, I need help with this, I don't understand exactly how to maneuver my way through this new system, They're being told that, gee, we're not going to help you. We simply are not going to help you because we don't like it. Now, obviously, those Republican extremists that are out there that seem to be driving this train. But how does that go over with the constituency when you say, gee, you know, well, I know that this is law, and I know that we help you with things like Social Security and other things like that, but we're not going to help you with Obamacare? That's how crazy it's gotten in places like Alabama, Texas, Mississippi, and, you know, all the regular suspect states.
And you're exactly right. And I believe that that rhetoric meets reality when people come together at dinner or the bowling alley or just in their real lives at work. And when people read about Americans in New York and Maryland and Connecticut and Montana and California and Oregon and their ability to access reasonably priced health care insurance, that rancid, regressive rhetoric is going to eventually, I don't know how long it will take, but eventually you would think that that would crash head on into reality, where Americans see other Americans using the instrument of the Affordable Care Act, receiving health care insurance at reasonable rates. And it would seem to me just obviously that people would say, well, wait a minute. Hello, I want that too.
In other words, somebody in Texas sees that somebody in Oregon is now paying cheaper rates for insurance. They're getting better care, and they're understanding that this is a good thing, and they start scratching their heads. So now, why is it that you passed on this deal? At some point, the Republicans have to face that. Look, inevitably, we do know this. It's likely that that the opposition to all this is going to disappear. It's not only going to moderate their crazy talk; they're going to disappear when we start seeing those benefits. And at this point, though, what we have is such a rabid attack that it's hard for somebody out there to understand, is this good or bad for them? Understand, this is a political campaign. This is unheard of. This is unprecedented. Here you have a law in place on the books, and you have something that looks like a political party campaign to try to dismantle that law. It doesn't really happen that much. I guess the last time we probably saw this was with something like in the heat of the civil rights fight. You know, you had some states that would come out and have, you know, commercial renditions of why that was a bad idea. But it's a rarity. But at this point, you have kind of the same suspects. You've got, you know, the same people we were used to seeing out there out on front of these kinds of arguments. Rand Paul, Ted Cruz, Tom Coburn, Marco Rubio, kind of the Confederacy of dunces, the Confederacy of boneheads, that I don't think they're really getting traction. What do you think, India?
I tend to agree with that, and I would say, as I articulate on my program, the very constituents that they are pitching to that the Affordable Care Act is bad and rooting for its failure and vowing assurance that it does fail, the very constituents that they're pitching that to, the constituents are paying for their health care.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and so-
I just think that this crashes into reality.
Well, what we see is the reality is that some Republicans in places like Ohio and Michigan, they've changed their minds. Now they're accepting this Medicaid expansion, and all of a sudden we're going to start seeing more of that, because anybody, I don't care how rabidly crazy they are, when you have your constituents say, now I don't quite understand why you passed on this. My uncle lives in Oregon. My uncle lives in Ohio or Michigan. I don't understand why I can't get the same thing my uncle gets. And then at some point, the rubber has to meet the road. Chickens have to come home to roost. And they have to say, well, it's because our governor was ordered to do this by the Koch regime. Our governor was bossed around like a child by the Koch brothers or whoever it may be, whatever part of that fight is out there on the other side. He was told not to accept the money. And somebody's going to have to answer that, aren't they?
Absolutely. They are going to have to answer that. And, you know, as most women who are the head of households, most women make the consumer decisions. And to me, I use the metaphor as, okay, where I live, a washer and dryer set is $3,000, but yet where someone else lives, the exact same washer and dryer set is $650. Well, why am I paying $3,000 for the exact same product that someone else is getting for a much reduced rate? I just think that common sense and reality are going to crash, and the people who have touted this rhetoric and this mindset of regression, not only on this issue but many others, are going to have to face that reality. It is my hope that people are engaged and connected and informed in how their elected officials, whom they're paying for their health care, are misleading them and selling them.
Yeah, just because
right
they're being ordered to.